Oh, hey guys, in today's video, I'm gonna help you pick the best budget MIDI keyboard controller for your Worship Keys rig. In today's video, we're gonna talk about what might be one of our absolute favorite budget-conscious MIDI keyboard controllers that could be a great fit for you and your Worship Keys rig. In this video, we're gonna talk about the M-Audio KeyStation 88. We'll talk about the features, some pros and cons, and why we think it might be the best budget option out there for those of you looking to buy a new MIDI keyboard. All right, so one of the great things about the KeyStation 88 is that it's pretty darn simple. There aren't a ton of features to speak of, and that might sound like a bad thing, but it can actually really work to your benefit. For one thing, because it's such a simple and straightforward controller, you don't pay for a bunch of features that you're not gonna use, like tons of onboard drum pads that light up, extra knobs and faders, and you can always add that sort of stuff with a second peripheral like the Korg Nano Control 2, or even via something like Touch OSC running on your iPad or iPhone. So this is a less intimidating keyboard for volunteers to get started with because it doesn't look like the inside of a spaceship. You have a pitch bend and a mod wheel. You have one fader that defaults to a volume control. You have octave up and down. Then there's the advanced button, and all that does is just let you change some stuff about the type of MIDI data that the controller sends. But right out of the box, it's gonna be plug and play compatible with Mainstage, Ableton Live, any DAW, whatever you need it to do. It's just gonna work right out of the box. So this is a full size 88 key keyboard. It's super lightweight, so if you are a portable church, you need to travel, or if you just wanna be able to set up your keys rig at home for practice, take it to rehearsal, set it up at church, and not be lugging around an 80-pound plus keyboard, this is a great option for that. But one of the things that some people aren't willing to sacrifice that might make this not the right fit for you is that there's a semi-weighted action to this keyboard. Now, if you're not familiar with what that means, every keyboard that you can buy, any MIDI controller, is gonna have a specific feel to the keyboard. Now, if you want something that feels like a traditional piano, that's gonna be a heavier feel, and that's gonna be generally referred to as a weighted action keyboard or something like a piano action. So there's gonna be a lot of resistance and sort of a feeling of weight to the keys, just like there's a physical mechanism actually moving and hitting the strings on an actual acoustic piano. So if you are somebody who is really used to that sort of real piano feel, a weighted keybed might feel the most natural for you. This has a semi-weighted feel, which means it's sort of in between the heaviness and the weightedness of a fully weighted keybed and something that's on the opposite side of the spectrum, which would be called a synth action, which has very, very little resistance. You can play really, really fast notes because there's not much pushback or weight to the keys. So if you're somebody that's playing a lot of synth parts, you might want a synth action keyboard, which would actually be even lighter than the response of this keybed on the KeyStation 88. For me, I actually really like a semi-weighted keyboard for a lot of contexts, especially if it's the only keyboard that I'm gonna be using, because then I sort of get the middle ground of both worlds. If I need to play piano parts, the keybed doesn't feel so plasticky and thin that I'm worried I'm gonna hit the wrong notes way too easily. At the same time, when I do need to play something like a lead part or a synth bass part, I don't feel like I have to hammer down really hard on the keys to get them to respond. And the great thing about that is semi-weighted keybeds are a lot less expensive generally than weighted keybeds because mechanically, they just don't cost as much to produce. Now, M-Audio did put out a hammer action, fully weighted version that's sort of like the big brother to the KeyStation line. It's just as simple. It is heavier, it's bulkier, and it's more expensive. But if you know you want a weighted, fully weighted sort of piano response from your keybed, then we'll put a link in the description to that keyboard as well. And the velocity response for being semi-weighted, I feel is pretty balanced. I do feel like I'm able to get a good amount of control over my dynamics and playing. If I need to play at lower velocities, I feel like I'm able to do that pretty well, but it's not as granular or as detailed as some of the higher end MIDI controllers out there. I think that for most live performances, this has never really been an issue for me. Plus, if you're in Mainstage or Ableton Live, you can always dial in the velocity response in those softwares to be exactly what you need. Now, next up, this is just a pure MIDI controller. There's no internal sounds. Oftentimes, if you buy this keyboard from a music retailer like Sweetwater or Musician's Friend, or if you buy it on Amazon, it might come bundled with some third-party software. Almost every MIDI peripheral you can buy in the world comes with Ableton Live Lite. So if you don't have software, you can usually get started with at least a few basic sounds via the bundled software that comes with this keyboard, but I'm going to assume that most of you, if you're buying a MIDI controller, you already know what you want to control with it. So you've decided on something like Mainstage, Ableton Live, maybe you're using Omnisphere. But the thing to note is that when you go with the full MIDI controller route, if your computer fails or crashes, you don't have a backup plan. So some people that really, really want that sort of extra peace of mind would prefer to spend more money to get a keyboard that has built-in sound. So if that's you, this keyboard is not going to cut it because there are no built-in sounds. But for me personally, I have been playing live without internal sounds as a backup for years and years, and I've never had a crash during a live performance. So if you're comfortable with optimizing your software rig and you have a computer that's up to the task, in my opinion, it makes a lot of sense to save some money, go the full MIDI only route, and then you can invest that money into either the computer that you're using or the software that you're using. Like I said just a minute ago, the great thing about this keyboard is it's class compliant. So there are no drivers to update as the software of your computer gets updated. It's just gonna work because it's just designed to plug and play. And that's gonna be true on both Mac and PC. So it just connects over USB straight into your computer. There's no power cables or anything like that. It can also be connected via old school 5-pin MIDI if that's something that is your preference, or if maybe you're chaining different MIDI controllers together, you have that option as well. Now, one thing that I really love about this keyboard, like I said a little while ago, is that it's really empty. There's nothing going on the top here. You've got lots of empty space. And I really like this because then if you have a controller of choice, like for me, that's the Korg Nano Control 2. I really love that controller. We use it to directly integrate with our Sunday Keys templates for Ableton and Mainstage. This controller just sits perfectly on top. You can use a little bit of gaff tape. I actually put some industrial Velcro on the back of my Nano Control 2. It's really, really straightforward. I love that there's all that extra room because so many MIDI keyboards on the market are just like from left to right covered in controls that I often don't end up actually relying on during a live performance, but it makes it more difficult to fit on the extra peripherals that I actually need within easy reach. Now let's talk about the back of this unit really quick. It's pretty simple. So you have a power input. Like I said, this can be powered over USB, or you can get a power adapter if you'd like, if you're running old school MIDI. Next, you've got a USB jack. This is just gonna transmit MIDI data to your keyboard, plug and play, and like I said, power. So it's really simple. You can send MIDI out of this controller. So if you wanna connect it to another keyboard, you can do that. And then you've got a sustain pedal input, pretty straightforward, pretty self-explanatory, and you have a volume jack. So if you want to, you can connect an expression pedal to this and get another additional amount of MIDI sent in to your DAW, into Mainstage, into Ableton Live. It's really nice to have that. Some people really like to use an expression pedal in place of their mod wheel, so having this volume port on the back makes it possible to do that or control any other parameter that you'd like. And then lastly, you've got a power switch here. So if you want, you can turn the controller off and leave everything plugged in, so you don't have to tear your rig apart or unplug from your computer to disconnect it from power. All right, so now let's talk a little bit about quality and reliability. If you look at the Amazon reviews, this keyboard currently has about a 3.5 star review. And just reading through some of those reviews, it looks like the most common reason for some of the lower star reviews is the keybed feel. And I think that's really not a fair reason to rate this keyboard poorly. I guess that's your preference, but it doesn't have anything to do to me with the quality of the keyboard, because it's advertised as semi-weighted, and I think as far as semi-weighted keyboards go, it is a good semi-weighted keyboard. After looking at the reviews, it doesn't seem like the issues are so much related to durability or reliability, but rather to just the personal preference of folks who may have picked up this keyboard expecting it to be something that it didn't end up being. Now, like most MIDI keyboards, this is all plastic, and it's very lightweight, so it might feel a little bit cheap to you, but I think that if you take good care of your gear, it's not gonna be an issue. I've had this keyboard personally for over 3 years. I've moved it around to different gigs playing at church. I've moved it around my home studio for different video shoots and stuff. I haven't had any issues with it as far as the exterior case. There's no cracks or anything. So I think it's a pretty darn high quality build for the price. Now, if you're looking for a MIDI controller that you can throw downstairs, this is not the MIDI controller for you. But other than super high-end options that have a real focus on durability, I think this keyboard is really in line with what I've seen from most other brands. Now, one thing I will say about the quality of this keyboard that has been a bummer for me, I don't feel that the travel of the mod wheel on the model that I've had is quite as full range as I would have hoped. When I started it off, I felt like when I got up to about 90% on the mod wheel, I was already reading 127 in my DAW. And over the last couple of years, I've noticed that sort of consistently shorten up to where now by the time I'm about 80% position on the mod wheel, I'm usually at 127 in my DAW. And that is a bummer for me because I use my mod wheel so much for changing up different sounds, and I wish I had that full travel. I also haven't done a lot of effort to see if it's something that I could adjust by just going in, opening up the keyboard and changing or cleaning out the pot, and maybe just taking a can of air and spraying in there to see if there's any dust or anything. But honestly, I wish that that wasn't even something I had to do. Ideally, it would just work. But again, that could just be specific to my model. It could also be because my kids love to throw guitar picks and pennies inside of the keyboard. Now let's talk about the price. This is one of the biggest selling points of this keyboard because currently it's only $229, which is crazy affordable for a full-sized 88-key keyboard that has pretty darn good build quality and has a pretty good reputation for lasting a long time. So you could get this keyboard, a sustain pedal, and a stand for under $300. Now, this market is getting more competitive. There's several sub $500 options now available for 88 keys, even fully weighted keyboards with 88 keys. And we'll link some of those in the description of this video. If you want to check those out and sort of compare and contrast between this one, you can. But if you know you need 88 keys and you're on a super tight budget, I don't think that you can really beat this one as long as you're willing to make some of the concessions about the keybed feel and you don't need any additional features on board. So to wrap things up, I really think the M-Audio KeyStation 88 is one of the best budget MIDI controller options out there. There's not really anything that can top it in terms of the value you get in the full-sized, semi-weighted 88 keys, the ease of use, the portability, and pretty good build quality for less than $250. All right, guys, we're gonna put links in the description to all the keyboards that we talked about in today's video. If you have questions still about which one to choose, leave a comment and let us know. Or if you've got a keyboard that you think should have been on the list, we wanna hear from you in the comments as well. Now, if you do click one of the links in the description, that's gonna take you over to Amazon, and it's an affiliate link. So if you choose to buy one of the keyboards via those links, then we're gonna receive a small kickback from the seller. So if you do choose to buy from one of those links, thanks a lot for the support. It makes it possible for us to do more gear reviews like this one. Have a great day. Today's video, we're gonna... My son always puts money into my keyboard controller. It's like a piggy bank.